डियर कलीग्स एंड फ्रेंड्स, एज वेल एज माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, मायसेल्फ डॉक्टर पी के वर्मा, इन कंटिन्यूएशन विथ डिस्कशंस ऑन द वेरियस टॉपिक्स ऑफ बायोटेक्नोलॉजी, टुडे आई शैल डिस्कस डीएनए फिंगरप्रिंटिंग। DNA fingerprinting is a very advanced technique of identification of an individual and comparison of the DNA samples of two different sources. But the term fingerprint is older than DNA fingerprinting, so let us at first discuss what is the fingerprinting. A fingerprint is an impression left by the friction ridge of a human finger. While making your Aadhaar card, you must have given fingerprints of all the 10 fingers in your hands. And whenever you wanted to link your Aadhaar number with your mobile number or the SIM card, you also have used one of your fingers on the scanner. The human fingerprints are detailed, nearly unique, difficult to alter, and durable over the life of an individual, making them suitable as long-term markers of human identity. They may be employed by police or other authorities to identify individuals who wish to conceal their identity. The recovery of partial fingerprints from a crime scene is an important method of forensic science. Similar to the fingerprints, DNA pattern of every individual also has unique pattern. Except the identical twins, every individual has many allelic differences and also differences in DNA-based composition in the non-genetic segment of the DNA. But sequencing of entire length of DNA and their matching with another sample is not practically possible. It is costly, time-taking, and needs a highly sophisticated DNA sequencer as well as a superpower like supercomputer. It has been found that only 1/10 of a single percent of DNA, about 3 million bases, differs from one person to another. These variations in individual genomes are found in terms of single nucleotide polymorphism, SNPs, insertions and deletions, that is indels, or copy number variations, or CNV. These three terms are used for the main chromosome of the human body or the body of any other organism. There are about 1.4 million locations where such individual variations are found. Scientists can use these variable regions to generate a DNA profile of an individual using samples from blood, bone, hair, and other body tissues and products. DNA can be extracted from the bones and teeth of very long buried deceased body also. Even after 6 months of burial, the bone marrow of the buried person and the pulp inside their teeth have DNA undecomposed. This profile was at first studied by Sir Alec Jeffrey in 1984 of Leicester University, UK. DNA fingerprinting or DNA typing is in fact its electrophoretic profile, and it is more reliable in forensic science than the fingerprints because the latter can be destroyed by burning and is always destroyed in decaying dead bodies. So let us begin with the topic by observing what are the techniques for DNA fingerprinting. The first one is restriction fragment length polymorphism, RFLP. When a restriction enzyme is used, it breaks the DNA at different lengths. Therefore, the fractions have various differing molecular weights and length. RFLP is a technique for analyzing the variable length of DNA fragments that results from digesting a DNA sample with a special kind of restriction endonuclease enzyme. This enzyme cuts DNA at a specific sequence pattern known as recognition sites. The presence or absence of certain recognition sites in a DNA sample generates variable length of DNA fragments, which are separated using gel electrophoresis. They are then hybridized with DNA probes that bind to the complementary DNA sequences in the sample. RFLP was one of the first applications of DNA analysis to forensic investigation. With the development of newer and more efficient DNA analysis technique, RFLP is not used as much as it once was because it requires relatively large amount of DNA. In addition, samples degraded by environmental factors such as dirt or mold do not work well with RFLP. The second technology is STR, short tandem repeat technology. It is used to evaluate a specific region or loci within nuclear DNA. Variability in STR regions can be used to distinguish one DNA profile from another. In DNA fingerprinting, generally these variable number tandem repeats, VNTRs, are studied. The Federal Bureau of Investigation, FBI, of USA uses a standard set of 13 specific STR regions for CODIS, a software program that operates local, state, and national database of DNA profiles from convicted offenders, unsolved crime scene evidences, and missing persons. The odds that one individual will have the same 13 loci DNA profile is about 1 in a billion. So in a billion, hardly 2 persons will have same DNA profile. PCR analysis is rather more swift, more rapid method. Polymerase chain reaction is used to make millions of exact copies of DNA from a biological sample. DNA amplification with PCR allows DNA analysis on biological samples as small as a few skin cells. As compared to RFLP, DNA samples would have to be about the size of a quarter. The ability of PCR to amplify such tiny quantities of DNA enables even highly degraded samples to be analyzed. The third or fourth is mitochondrial DNA analysis. You know that Mitochondria is transferred to us from the mother's ovum, not from father. So it relates the maternal side of the individual. Mitochondrial DNA analysis, mtDNA, can be used to examine the DNA from samples that cannot be analyzed by RFLP or STR. While older biological samples that lack nucleated cellular materials such as hair, bones and teeth cannot be analyzed by STR and RFLP, they can be analyzed by mitochondrial DNA. All mothers have the same mitochondrial DNA as their offsprings because the mitochondria of each new baby comes from the mother's egg cell. The mother's sperm, father's sperm contributes only the nuclear DNA. It is very interesting that mitochondrial DNA is conserved since millions of years in every individual. Comparing the mitochondrial DNA profile of unidentified remains with the profile of a potential maternal relatives can be an important technique in missing persons investigation. The Y chromosome analysis is the last technique. The Y chromosome is passed directly from father to son. So analysis of genetic markers on the Y chromosome is especially useful for tracing relationship among males or for analyzing biological evidences involving multiple male contributors. Now come to the mostly used technique, that is analysis of the satellite DNA. In eukaryotes, when DNA of a chromosome is hydrolyzed with the help of restriction endonuclease and the mixture of DNA fragments is subjected to buoyant density gradient centrifugation. Here the term is buoyant density gradient centrifugation. Most of the fragments with similar 80:GC ratio form one major band, but those having a difference in the base composition form a separate band, hence called satellite DNA. If the AT pair is higher than GC, it has less molecular weight, and when GC pair is higher than AT, it has less molecular weight, and in this way their buoyancy differ, so they separate from the main band. Such satellites are formed due to repetitions of simple sequences. In the course of evolution, these segments have undergone several unequal crossing overs, as a result of which there is a marked variation in repetitions of these simple sequences, or creating insertions and deletions, that is indels. Depending on their base composition, length and repetitions, their weights differ and they form different bands in the density gradient centrifugation. Depending on this, these have been classified in different ways. There are two types of simple sequence satellites. In the most common form, repeats of 1 to 13 base pairs, in tandem repeats of 150 base pairs or less are found. These are known as microsatellites. The other is repeats of 14 to 500 base pairs, in tandem repeats of 20 to 100 kilobases. These are called mini satellites. So microsatellites are smaller, much smaller than the mini satellites. These can be identified also in a chromosome by fluorescence in situ hybridization. that is face. Here the DNA is hybridized with fluorescent substances inside the cell. The abbreviation FISH is very interesting. It is for fluorescence in situ hybridization. In the DNA, the satellites and other parts can be fragmented by specific endonucleases and after electrophoresis, followed by southern blotting. These fragmentations can be identified by hybridization with DNA probes. So you need a sample of DNA. You have to isolate satellite DNA using restriction endonuclease and buoyant density centrifugation. Now you have to undergo the process of electrophoresis, and after that southern blotting is done. The matching is done after hybridization with DNA probes. So let us know about DNA probes. These are single-stranded DNA or RNA molecules which can make complementary base pairs with certain segments of DNA. In case of DNA fingerprinting, probes complementary to the short repeated sequence of microsatellite or minisaccharide DNA is prepared. These are labeled either with radioactive elements like 32P. Normal molecular weight, atomic weight of phosphorus is 30. Or are bound with biotin, a vitamin, or digoxygenin, a plant product, etc. The radio level probes have shorter lifetime than the biotin leveled probes, so it is easier to be detected. In human genome, only 13 to 15 such conjunct sequences are found, which show variations from person to person. So probes against these regions only are used for this purpose. I have already discussed that FBI uses only 13 regions. A series of probes bound to a DNA sample creates a distinctive pattern for an individual. Forensic scientists compare these DNA profiles to determine where the suspect sample matches the evidence sample. Now see how beautifully the DNA can be observed after tagging them with the probes. Now see an example. From the crime scene, police observes presence of a blood sample different from sample of the victim. Now three persons are caught. These are named as suspect 1, suspect 2, suspect 3. Their blood is taken and their individual electrophoretic profile is made. You can now just compare the three suspects with the blood sample present at the scene of crime. You can confirm that this blood matches with the blood of suspect number 2. So she was present or he was present at the site of crime. Now what is southern blotting? E.M. Southern developed this technique for a proper identification and documentation of DNA after electrophoresis. The DNA fragments are subjected to agarose gel electrophoresis on a slab. It is a normal method. After the run is over, the gel is incubated in alkaline medium to break the hydrogen bonds and single-stranded DNAs are formed on the surface of the gel. The sheet of gel is transferred to a blotting paper, Wattman's paper. Normally, these are numbered 1 to 50 and so on. With increasing number, the thickness increases. With extra length or beaks in each side and put on a thick glass plate. The glass plate is placed on the horizontal electrophoresis set, filled with buffer in both the reservoirs, and the beaks are dipped into the buffer so that the gel may soak the buffer regularly. Now a sheet of nitrocellulose paper or nylon is covered over the slab gel. A thick layer of paper absorbent or the paper towel is put over the nitrocellulose or nylon sheet and a heavy slab is placed over this absorbent. These are left for many hours in this condition. The buffer passing through Wattman paper, slab gel and nitrocellulose or nylon sheet is finally absorbed by the paper absorbent. The DNA bands present in the gel gradually move to nitrocellulose or the nylon sheet and stick to its surface. It is now dried and heated at 80 degrees Celsius for 2 to 3 hours to fix the bands of DNA on the membrane. It can be preserved for long time. For DNA fingerprinting, the nitrocellulose sheet is incubated with radio-labeled probes and the extra probe is washed away. It is put over X-ray plate in dark for a few minutes and the plate is developed to observe the bands. Now a photographic system also has been developed so that the photograph can be preserved in the computer. It is called gel documentation system. Now these are the steps. Restriction enzyme digests DNA. Electrophoresis is conducted. After that, southern blotting is done. Now, the DNA samples come on the nitrocellulose paper. The extra probe is washed away and only the bands are left on the nitrocellulose paper. Now these are X-rayed and so a X-ray film is prepared in this way. Application of DNA fingerprinting. DNA fingerprinting is used to determine parental relationship of a child. In a child, 50% DNA comes from mother and another 50% from father. So the child must match 50-50 with both parents. There are many occasions when parentage of the child has to be tested. You may have heard about the incidence of change of children in the hospital, or a child lost or stolen and recovered after many years. In these cases, parental relationship of the child is determined by DNA fingerprints. Deceased persons who cannot be identified physically or the dead body which has been destroyed severely are identified on the basis of their DNA fingerprints matched with the parents, brothers and sisters. In case of riots, earthquakes and terrorist attack, the body becomes badly demolished, such as in the attack on WTO. In such cases also, the DNA of deceased sample can be compared with their parents' DNA or sibling to establish relationship. In criminal cases, DNA fingerprints is used as forensic evidence. For example, in a murder case, blood stains are found on the shirt, jeans and shoes of two suspects who deny being present at the scene of crime. DNA fingerprints of the blood samples collected from the clothes and shoes of these suspects are compared with the sample of the victim. If the pattern matches, the suspect has contributed the evidence sample. Experts opine that using DNA forensic technology is far superior to eyewitness account. Now, let us take a case. There is a child. The mother says that Mr. Falana is his father, but the alleged person denies the fact. Now, three different probes have been used. You can see that in first case, the DNA band of the child matches with one band of mother and another band of the alleged father. When another probe is used, again one band of child matches with mother and another band matches with the alleged father. Third sample also shows one band of mother and one band of the alleged father similar to the bands of the child. In the fourth probe also, child tallies with one band of mother and another band of the alleged father, so it is confirmed that that person is father of that child. Now, here is a victim. His blood is found on the body of some suspect, but the suspect denies. When the DNA present or gene, the shirts of two suspects were analyzed and compared, you can see that the samples matches. These three samples match with the blood sample of the victim. And therefore, this person was present at the scene of murder, or he was the person who killed the victim. It is another case in which a girl was raped. From her vagina, the sperm cells were isolated and its DNA profile was prepared. When it was compared with a number of victims, a number of suspects, suspect number one had the same matching pattern as the vagina smear of the victimized girl, and therefore suspect number one is the culprit who raped the girl. So now you have become a technical expert of this very powerful diagnostic and forensic tool. See you in the next session. Thank you. Thank you very much.